Midnight Oil. That should be the attitude. I so submit.
陳克勤議員.
Mr. Gary Chen. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Madam Deputy, I speak in support of Paul Chair's proposal to amend the rules of procedure. As you said in your speech just now, the amendments cover many areas, and we have actually debated on this for 3 hours, and many members have already spoken on the details of the resolution, and therefore I'm not going to repeat those that have been said. But then I'd just like to specifically explain why we have to make this round of amendment, and also the rationale behind this, and also the spirit behind this. Well, when it comes to the rules of procedure that we have here, well, we have already done so on 2 occasions, and I was also deeply involved on both occasions, and therefore I'd like to take the opportunity to explain to you why we have to change them again. Well, as soon as we said that we needed to amend the rules of procedure, the opposition lawmakers and also their supporters would just make one point. And they said that by amending the rules of procedure, you're actually undermining the room for lawmakers to speak in this council. So that's the whole point that they've been making. In fact, the rules of procedure would not be changed out of the blue. So we've been having this council for over 23 years. The reason why we didn't change that in the past, that's because in running this council, we didn't have such bizarre tactics being deployed that ran against the order of this council. That's because the Burn With Us lawmakers breached the consensus of this council and cause chaos to this council, and that's the reason why we had to change it, or else we wouldn't have had to change it so dramatically and so often. And on this occasion, we are trying to amend the rules of procedure to prevent lawmakers from deploying filibustering tactics, because there's damage done, and therefore we have to rectify it. If there is a destruction caused, and if we do not rectify it, then the responsibility would lie squarely on us. It's precisely like what we did with some pieces of legislation. In fact, there would have been no need to legislate had it not been for people breaking the rules and regulations. If there had not been people breaking the law and order situation, we would not have had the need to legislate in order to regulate their behavior. So that's a very important reason why we have to change the rules of procedures. And secondly, there are 2 concepts that have to be set out clearly. Number one, we have to change the norm that was not normal. And second, we would also have to change with time, because for a long time, this council relies very heavily on lawmakers behaving themselves. It's not just confined to Hong Kong. In overseas jurisdictions, they've been doing the same. Or in some cases, they had several hundred lawmakers. And if everybody abuses the rules of procedure, then the council simply would not be able to function. And therefore, we need to have a set of rules to regulate the behavior of lawmakers. So this set of rules would very much be a set of gentlemen's agreement. And if we do not follow those rules, if we do not comply with the rules, if we just shout and chant slogans, and if we just come out and throw foul water and so on, then how can this council function? And very often you can see many from the opposition camp, and what they did was they would create a situation whereby there would be chaos, and the whole meeting would have to come to a standstill because we couldn't hear anything that the official said. If they did so every time, and if every time you let them off the hook, and if there is no price to pay, and if they just would be evicted at the time, and then they can come back again the next day, then for those who are taking these meetings very seriously, it's grossly unfair to them. And there are also opposition lawmakers, as soon as they came into this council, they already came with those ideas. Because I would be expressing my political views, and then I would just bring the whole meeting to a standstill, and then I would steal the limelight, and then I would be seen on screen that I was carried out of this chambers, and I can just put it on my Facebook post, and then I would get credits and commendations or compliments from my supporters. So they have no intention whatsoever to voice their justifications here in this council. All right, they would gain political mileage, and yet this council would be brought to a standstill, and that's the biggest price that we all have to pay. So for these lawmakers, if there is no penalty whatsoever, then it's highly likely that what I described just now would happen time and time again. Yes, after the mass resignation by the opposition camp, in the future, if we were to have similar members joining this council, they would once again be able to halt the function of halt the operation of this council. And that's the reason why we have to put in place this suspension penalty, and of course there would also be a fine imposed on them by deducting their pay and so on. And I'd like to say this, well, just now I heard Mr. Yu Si Wing say that he was only prepared to agree with the suspension penalty, and there is no reason why we should impose this fine on a scale of severity of their behavior. I also agree that there should only be suspension, but then for the penalty or the fine, well, I would have reservation, because by suspending him from the business of this council is already a very serious penalty. But then after consultation, because amongst us pro-establishment lawmakers, we discussed that ourselves, we believe that we should adopt this two-pronged approach. So that's the consensus. So we would be adopting this dual-track approach. So while we suspend him from the business of this council, we would also be imposing a financial penalty. Yes, people would say that without the opposition camp, you pro-establishment lawmakers would just be a rubber stamp. Well, you can see that that's not the case, because UC Wing has his views and I have my own views. But then in the end, if we have to make a decision, then we have to make a compromise. We have to reach a consensus, or else how can this council function? If it's like what the opposition camp did in the past, they would always think that they were on the right, and therefore they would not be prepared to make compromise, and they would just be blocking the meetings, and they would just prevent us from voting on motions and resolutions and so on. How can this council function? All right, many colleagues would say that when we see that the rules of procedure have loopholes, and if we do not plug them, then the responsibility would in fact have to be shouldered by this council itself. So it's hard for us to shirk the responsibility, and therefore this is a very difficult decision for this council to amend the rules of procedures. In fact, we have had very in-depth discussion on this, and we have thought hard about this before we came to this decision. Well, many members have said that just a couple of years ago, when we elected the chairman of the House Committee, there was this saga, because the deputy chairman then abused his power as deputy chairman in the election. In fact, he did not have the power to deal with a point of order, but then he made use of that to delay the procedures, and he prevented us from electing the chairman and the vice chairman of the House Committee, given that we had that hard lesson to learn. And then in 6 months or even longer, we hadn't been able to elect the chairman of the House Committee, and for panel chairman, the election also experienced the same thing. And if we did not plug those loopholes, then would that happen again in the future? And if that should happen again, then we wouldn't have done our job properly. So that's what I said. We have to correct what's wrong. And also to move with time. I think it's a very simple idea or concept, because for every council, we have to change with time. So obviously, for the future of this council, because of the NPCSC's decision, we're going to see its membership increased from 70 to 90. And as a result of that, our meeting time will be lengthened. And if we want to function effectively and have our meetings held efficiently, then in certain procedures, the speaking time for individual members will have to be reduced correspondingly. Why do we have to cut the speaking time? That's to enable more members to be able to speak. And therefore, we shouldn't just say that we're restricting the speaking time for individual members. We are not allowing them to speak. That's wrong. So it's not like what the opposition camp said. Only they had a say and other people should not have a say. That's not fair. Because to be fair, we have to make sure that everybody will have a chance to speak and they have the same amount of time to speak. And under the rules of procedure, we would also be including this amendment in order to change with time because of COVID-19. We allow members to use the video conferencing software to participate in meetings, and also when you try to speak, we would also make it explicit that they would also be subject to the protection under the Powers and Privileges Ordinance. As a result of that, members' speeches would be better protected. It's not just confined to Hong Kong. Other countries have been doing much faster than us. So, Mr. President, concerning this round of amendment to the rules of procedure, we do have good justifications and it's targeting the loopholes of the rules of procedure and it's very pragmatic and therefore there is a need for us to do so. I support Mr. Paul Chair's amendments.
Go ahead, Chair.
Mr. Felix Cheung, thank you, President. My speech will be short. Of course, we all support the motion and amendments moved by Mr. Paul Chair. As Mr. Gary Chan has said, why make all the amendments since we didn't have any in the past 20 years? Well, these rules are or used to be gentlemen's rules, but we didn't have any gentlemen. We have many rascals instead. So it's only normal that we should amend our rules. Many members have touched on the details, which I don't want to repeat. They are about what happened in the past. So I won't repeat them. The question is, after the amendments, are we going to make use of the amended rules to facilitate the discussions and debates in this council? Of course, when the amendments were proposed, we didn't have the MPC decision on the new electoral system. That's why the amendments were proposed based on past experience, based on the behavior of the opposition camp in the past. And next Monday or Tuesday, when the MPC SC came up with the new electoral system, stipulating that all future candidates or electoral members are patriots, then there may be no need for the presidents to invoke the rules to the evict members. So I think the intention of moving this amendment is good. But I would also speculate that the amended rules might not be necessary. No need to suspend anyone, no need to impose financial sanction on anyone. And the president in the future will not need to bother with exercising such powers. And by sheer coincidence, just when we want to shorten the speaking time limits, and then we know in the future there will be 90 members instead of 70. And if the same speaking time is allowed, the meeting time will be extended as a matter of necessity. For example, we have 40-odd members. We have spent 3 to 4 hours on the amendments. If we have 90, then the chairman, president, you may have to sit there for double the meeting time we have had. I think the amended rules would enhance our efficiency. Members talk about filibustering, the election of committee or panel chairman. I think we are not going to see a recurrence of what happened to the election of each House committee chairman. Well, future LegCo members, whether they are from the for establishment or pandemic camps, no one would dare to misbehave in the future. So with the amended rules or with the rules improve and enhance, I believe these times and efficiency and speed with which we handle council business will much be improved. And as a result, Hong Kong would be much smoother in carrying out our business.
Mrs. Elizabeth Quad, I remember in the past, whenever we watched from the news, the legislative yuan in Taiwan, in which members would engage in fights, a hurling of shoes even, we would criticize the Taiwan's parliament as very substandard. Instead, we thought that the Legislative Council here in Hong Kong was very civilized and we would act rationally. It's been 9 years since I joined this council, and I've witnessed how Hong Kong's Legislative Council had once been made something akin to the Legislative Yuan in Taiwan. For the Burn With Us camp and the opposition camp, for the sake of getting limelight, they continue to escalate the level of violence they use in this council to create chaos. That is why I support the motion today. I think it's time we rectify the mistakes. The rules of procedure in this council is based on gentlemen's agreement. However, like I said, our council's culture has deteriorated a lot, and members of the public would come to me whenever I erected street booth that our council is a rubbish council. It's really sad to hear that, because I joined this council with the only purpose of speaking out for women, for green groups, for improving people's livelihood, and to fight the corner of my INT sector. However, in recent years, apart from engaging in debates in promoting government policies, we had to engage in fights as well. And on more than one occasion, we had to call the police, and some members were even sent to a hospital to examine the injuries. From hurling of a banana, to hurling of a glass, to pungent wastewater, the Burn With Us camp frantically tried to stall the progress of the council and resorted to repeating some really absurd, silly questions in the council and moving meaningless motions incessantly, all for the sake of opposing the central authorities, for the sake of it. Like Mr. Dennis Kwok, there was a 7 or 8 months delay when he presided over election of chair of the House committee. No chairman was returned, and we also witnessed the Burn With Us culture in this council. Some members would insult government officials, they would shout profanities, they would charge at the chairman's platform and create chaos. Witnessing all this physical violence, I can't help but think that I'm wasting my youth, but more importantly, we're wasting Hong Kong's time. Hong Kong is a very efficient city. We have the can-do spirit, but then in recent years, our progress has been getting slower and slower. Neighboring cities are catching up with us. I'd like to promote innovation technology, but then the pace of development is really, really slow, and we're overtaken by Shenzhen. The reason why this is happening, Mr. President, is that many members exploited the loopholes in the rules of procedure, which is based on gentlemen's agreement. They resorted to exploiting these loopholes in the rules of procedure in order to undermine the interests of Hong Kong. So I think the current term of LegCo should amend the rules of procedure to tackle these problems. Some might say that since we will ensure only patriots administer Hong Kong, there is no need to amend the rules of procedure. I beg to differ. I think it is our duty to amend the rules of procedure. I'm also a member of the Committee on Rules of Procedure, and I think that these proposals are really comprehensive in tackling the problems I mentioned. In the past, some members engaged in really grossly disorderly conduct in the council, and the president could only give a warning and ask the member to withdraw from the chamber, and yet the member could return very soon. If we are to truly punish the member concerned, we need to move at least a censure motion. Meanwhile, there is no penalty. But now with the amendment in place, we have a progressive approach in metering out punishment along with financial penalty. Hopefully, this would serve sufficient deterrence so that no more members would make this publicity stunt to stall the council's operation and breaking the rules of procedure. And also for committee chairman, before a new chairman is elected, the former chair of the committee will be empowered to deal with normal business of the committee. These are all necessary amendments and important amendments. I hope that after the amendments are passed today, the Legislative Council of Hong Kong can really go back on the right track and safeguard the interests of Hong Kong people. This is also the public's aspiration. They would like to see us do real work and to resolve Hong Kong's problems. We have a lot of imminent issues to tackle. In the past, it was very difficult to tackle these problems because of the delaying tactics. Yesterday, we passed a motion on a collocation arrangement at Wangang Port. Imagine if the Burn With Us camp were still in this council, they would of course abuse the ROP again and call for quorums repeatedly. They would continue to charge at the president and we will be besieged. They would also incite violence. It would be impossible, or at least hard to believe, that the Wangang Porter motion will be passed in the council like we did yesterday. And yet this is something that we should do and must do. So we also have a lot of issues to tackle: housing, education, welfare, etc. We also like to grasp on the opportunities presented by the dual circulation strategy of our nation and the 14th five-year plan. There is a lot to do, so I support the amendments. I hope that the motion is passed so that we can restore normalcy in the council. I so submit.
Mr. Kwok Wai Kang. Thank you, Mr. President. I speak in support of the Chairman of the Commission on Rules of Procedure, Mr. Paul Chair, in moving the resolution to change the rules of procedure. During the past few years, I'd like to thank the Secretariat for collecting the practices of different parliaments all over the world, and a lot of consultation work has also been carried out by the Secretariat. Well, after massive chaos, there'd be a long time of good order. So it's like what happened in the Tang Dynasty when Emperor Taizong said this. That is after the time of chaos, we would have to do something to make sure that there would be good changes in our society. But then his subordinate, Wei Zong said that, we all know that after the Black Plague storm, we have to do something about it, or else if no reforms are undertaken, then for people who had suffered just before the end of the storm, they would not feel good. So after the what happened in 2019 and 2020, well, we also suffered very badly, and therefore we had to do something about it, or else we would continue to suffer. Well, the rules of procedure should not be changed haphazardly unless it's absolutely necessary. They came up with different justifications why we should not change the rules of procedure. But then I personally think that to amend the rules of procedure is something that is easy to understand. A simple example of this is that if you just have somebody knocking on your knee, then naturally your reflex will mean that you would move your knuckle. So even for the band, well, for the opposition camp and the band with us camp, they are actually hitting this council, and if we do not give them a response, then we are totally incompetent. So I don't think we need to explain or justify our acts, but then I'm sure the public would understand that there are reasons behind this and what the justifications are. Well, the move to change the rules of procedure are concentrated on five areas, but then most of them would be concentrated on the red card and yellow card system. I think the objectives are clear, because in the past, the rules of procedure were not tight, and that's the reason why we have to introduce this red and yellow card system. All right, if the penalty has not been strict, so then is it because you personally think that it's not strict enough? So how are we going to define it? I think there is an objective standard. That is, under the original rules of procedures, is the deterrent clear enough? All right, we can see that it's not just a small group of people filibustering and also throwing bananas. As a result, the Burn With Us camp are trying to usurp power. And then the occasion on which they break the rules was becoming more often and frequent. And that goes to show that the penalties were not severe enough. In fact, too many things have happened in this council. The opposition camp initially just pressed the objection button or the no button, whether or not it's about giving out cash payments and so on. And then subsequently, they would throw the glasses and throw bananas, and they would also be using the amplifiers and loudspeakers to shout and chant slogans and so on. And then they would even lock our lockers, and then they would also be bringing their loudspeakers in, and they would also storm the chairman's table, and then they would throw foul bombs or foul eggs and so on. And then they would show what their real intention was, and they're trying to burn with us. And in 6 months, 7 months, we had not been able to elect our House Committee Chairman. So all they were trying to do was to ruin this council so that we would not be able to function properly. All right, if you separate those things and incidents, you'd say that, all right, they are becoming more and more radical because they'd like to attract more votes and they'd like to steal the limelight. And every time when they did so, they might seem to be more and more radical. But then if you summarize what they had done over the past 10 years, and if you looked at that as a series of actions, then you see that there is a storyline behind that. There is a plot there. So they are trying to link themselves with a foreign power. So they are trying to ruin this council. They are trying to ruin this society. You can see that this council is representing Hong Kong. All right, the chaos in this council would also undermine the image of Hong Kong in the international community, and therefore what you see. So they are trying to identify another sovereign. So they are trying to usurp the power. They are trying to adopt this burn with us approach in ruining this, ruining this council. Initially, they started with a moderate move, and then they would become more and more radical as they went along. And then they'd say that they would like to get over 35 seats from this council because they'd like to take over this council. And then, as you can see, they'd like to ruin Hong Kong, and yet Hong Kong did not fail. But then they've been able to find their wrong homes, or hometown, so to speak. Okay, I've set out the reasons. That is, we will have to look at these as a series of things, and therefore, we have to do something about it. And the central authorities have already perfected the election system. I think this is the major move by the CPG, so that after the chaos, we're going to have an era of good order. And then for the $2.38 million or panel or signatures that have been collected, that's the public's view. So we don't want to see a repeat of what happened in the past 2 years. We don't want to see the Burn With Us campaign again. But then in the end, these rules of procedures can only prevent the gentlemen from doing bad things, but not the rascals. Well, to be more honest, in fact, we would not be able to prevent the bad guys from doing bad things because Paul Chair and some of our colleagues, when they had a meeting, well, with this red and yellow card system in place, it's not the first time we discussed it. In the past few years, we had discussed that on different occasions, and the reason why we had to engage in this extensive consultation exercise, that's because the opposition camp also had members in the CROP, and they were staunchly against this amendment. Well, it's not just about the wording of the amendments and what they showed, because I was also a member at those meetings. Well, the public would not be able to see that because it's a closed door, those would be closed door meetings. So what they said was, yes, they had legal backgrounds, but then they gave us the impression that they would be allowed to do so legitimately because there is no such restriction under the rules of procedures, and therefore they had the right to cause chaos, and therefore it's only fair and justified for them to do chaos, and they would also give us a black face when they joined the meeting. So that's what happened at the meetings. It's really hard to put up with that. But then, well, colleagues did work together, and then we managed to tide over that difficult time. So we don't want to repeat what had happened in Taiwan, because I think the memory was still fresh, because when I was still a primary school student, I could see that the lawmaker in Taiwan would use the shoes against the face of another member. So people would think that, well, Taiwan was chaotic. How come it's like a third world country? Well, who would have thought that in Hong Kong, we would follow their footsteps and engage in such acts? I hope that after the era of chaos, we would enter an era of good governance. If we did not make improvements to the rules of procedure, then people would query, how come we have not learned the lesson from our painful lesson or painful experience? And if we fail to do that, then actually we are encouraging them to do bad things. And timing is very important. After the era of chaos, we will have to ensure that there will be an era of good governance, and we have to manage the shock. And we would also have to protect our colleagues, and I'm referring to the security staff here, because between 2017 and 2020, well, our security staff had to deal with the conflicts in this council, and they also have to maintain order in this council, and there were 16 occasions or incidents. There were 16 incidents involving security staff getting injured in the course of their duty. So we don't want to see that happen again. But then when the Ben Bodasa came trying to steal the limelight, very often they would lose their common sense, and they would not be bothered about the security or safety of the security staff. They would climb up and down the chairs and tables, because all of a sudden they would just engage in a free fall, and the security staff would have to try and make sure that they would not fall, or else they would just claim that you had tripped them or you had caused their injuries. So very often we would have to talk to our security staff. They had a hard time because number one, even if they had sustained injury, they could not report the case to the police on their own initiative. And also in terms of the distribution of workload, because they had a very tight manpower establishment. So if one colleague got injured, then the others would have to take over and substitute them. And that would also add to the pressure of those who are working. And therefore, for the reported cases, there were only 16. But then I'm sure there must have been more, because they don't want to affect other colleagues at work, because they have a very strong team spirit. They didn't want to affect their colleagues' work. I suspect that there were more injuries, and if we were able to increase the penalties, that would help. And also for the suspension, well, 1 week, 2 weeks, and 4 weeks. So we are doubling it that as the situation escalates. I think there are justifications for that too. And Mr. President, there are things that we need to resolve. That is, they often abuse the rules of procedure. Well, on this occasion, we would just be focusing on the disorderly behavior. But then, when it comes to abusing the point of order, would that constitute as disorderly conduct? Well, it's of course up to the president to decide. But then in the past, what we saw was many from the Burn With Us camp, well, they resort to the rules of procedure. Well, in fact, it had nothing to do with the rules of procedure. In fact, they should have followed a strict procedure. For example, they would have to refer to which rule had been broken before. They would invoke that. But then they would just say that there are things that had happened, and those would be unrelated matters, and then they would just drag on and on without elaborating on the justifications. And therefore, we will have to rely on the good judgment of the president to deal with that in order to prevent them from abusing the rules of procedure again. And of course, there is an amendment about the speaking time of members. I think it's very simple, as many members have spoken on that already. Well, in order to perfect the election system, the number of seats in this council will be increased from 70 to 90, as there will be more members and more participants, and therefore every individual speaking time will have to be limited, because we only have council meetings on Wednesdays and Thursday, and therefore it's only reasonable that we should restrict the speaking time, because we are all faced with a situation whereby there are limited resources. And of course, if you say that, well, I'd like to engage in lengthy talks, I'd like to spend a few days on this, yes, nobody can stop you from doing that. But then for this council to function, we would also have to ensure that our time is spent wisely. We will have to restrict the time in order to ensure that resources are used in the optimal way. And how can we do that? We will have to distribute the time evenly so that there'll be equal participation by each and every member. So I'm glad that we have come to this stage, and I hope that for the effective operation of this council is a good start, and this would also provide a blueprint for our future operation. I hope that all colleagues can work together to effectively scrutinize the bills submitted by the administration and continue with our work so that we can improve people's livelihood and develop our economy so that we can all make contributions. Thank you.
Ms. Nasu Kafai, thank you, President. The chairman of the Liberal Party, Mr. Tommy Chung, has already spoken on the proposed amendment to the rules of procedure. Originally, I didn't want to speak again, but many members have mentioned what happened in the past. Also, a lot of memory flashes back. The amendment As a move by Mr. Paul Chair, as Chairman of the Committee on Rules of Procedure, a lot of time went into this because they had to look into all the rules one by one and also consider the loopholes that we had. Why do we need to have a legislature enacting laws? Why do we have to live as a community and not living alone? Because if a big number of us live together, we have to protect ourselves. And of course, we need to have rules to regulate the conduct of individuals in a community. Otherwise, things will be chaotic. And that's why all communities have laws. And therefore, we need to have rules for our council. We want to plug loopholes. Some people ask whether we are restricting ourselves, whether we're tightening up the powers of members. Well, this is about improvement to our rules. Well, you know, in one incident, people splash foul water, the smelly water, beside me. And on one occasion, I couldn't finish my lunch, and I had to stop for four times. They cover one eye in support of a woman whose eye was injured. Well, we didn't know whether how the injury was caused, and they didn't compromise. They delay things, not just in this council. We wasted time more than 6 months in the election of the House Committee. Therefore, we have to amend the rules. I believe the people of Hong Kong will support us. Of course, there are pros and cons. Many members have criticized their wrong behavior, but there are also benefits. In the past, I thought that the president had a good job to do. He didn't have to participate in any panel or committee meeting, and he would just speak a few words and chair the meeting. But in the past six months or so, I have come to realize that the president has a difficult job on many occasions. He had to come out to reject very ridiculous motions. And then we didn't have a House Committee chairman for some 6 months, and there was no House Committee chairman to stand in for the president. So the president had to sit for a long period of time during our committee. And he had to pay attention to what members spoke. It was very difficult. And I really appreciate your efforts, Mr. President.
No.
Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I thank Mr. Paul Chair, who chairs the Committee on Rules of Procedure, in proposing the amendments to the Rules of Procedure. I'd also like to thank the President and Deputy President of the Council, as well as the Secretariat, for leading us through the very difficult times in the recent years. I am fully supportive of this amendment exercise. I've been in this council for 17 years, and I witnessed the change in the culture of this council. We used to have respect for the council. It used to be a solemn place. But is now being criticized by the public as a rubbish council is really sad. Now, I've heard that many members support these amendments. I support them as well. However, we must not be complacent. After laying down rules, we need to make sure they are implemented. If there is no enforcement of the rules, then they would be rendered meaningless. So in future, members must say no to the bad elements. Second, and this is for members of the public. For the unscrupulous tricks, the public should also say no to these members. As for the media, please don't glorify thuggish behavior. Because you should not refrain from criticizing them. You should not praise them even to boost their morale. So in the future, for the sake of the Legislative Council and the whole of Hong Kong, after we weather the storm of social incidents and the epidemic, I look forward to a new council culture. Once again, I thank Mr. Paul Chair for leading the Committee on Rules of Procedure. I thank the President again. Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I now call upon Mr. Paul Chair to reply. Then the debate will come to a close. Mr. Paul Chair. Mr. President, first of all, I thank all the members, over half of the Council, who have spoken and expressed support for my motion. I also thank them for expressing support for my work, but I think a lot of the praise should go to the legal advisor and the secretariat of the council. So perhaps I should cover certain grounds, points that haven't been raised, and I'd like to clarify a number of points. First of all, I thank members for putting forward this concept of keeping up with the times. Mr. Kok Wai Kung just now said, well, mentioned the knee-jerk reflex or knee-jerk reaction. I don't think it's appropriate to term our exercise as such, because the motion or the amendment to the rules of procedure is a very stringent exercise. It's not a knee-jerk reaction as such. We've done analysis and studies for years before floating the proposals. Now, some members ask why we should proceed with the amendment exercise. Like I said in my opening remarks, it's time to rectify the mistakes. And it is just like the virus being spread in the community without vaccination, without antibodies. We live in fear. Now that we have the antibody, we can fight the virus, and this amendment exercise is one way to boost our immunity. Now, another member asked whether this is really gilding the lily, because the amendment bill will be floated very soon. Now, I would say that this motion doesn't target a particular political party or individual member. If we have a clear set of rules, everyone can abide by them. In fact, pro-establishment camp members also once being asked to leave the chamber. Mr. Kok Wai Kung, even Mr. Chan Kin Po was asked by the Democratic chairman to leave the chamber. It's not abuse as such. Now, we also have cases to follow based on the old rules of procedure. With new interpretation of the new ROP, it will be a new chapter for the president to have a clean slate. to have new interpretation of the ROP. It is important because one of the criticisms we face is that the parliamentary culture here is deteriorating because of our inefficient enforcement of the rules. Now, if we give a clean slate for the president of the council, he will have the opportunity, or the president will be given a new opportunity to interpret the rules of procedure in a new way to make progress in the council. If you're a sports fan, be it football or NBA, basketball, you would understand that all rules should be updated to keep up with the times. In the past, we didn't have a VR as referee or assistive referee. Well, anyway, coming to football, Dr. Priscilla Leung mentioned Brazil versus France. Well, I feel quite perplexed. It's really a game that happened in 1998, not the recent game. But I suppose we remember this World Cup match. It seems to have happened quite a long time ago. Anyway, I also mentioned in my opening remarks that there should be dignity in the council. And many members cited the incident in which the banana was hurled. And this is really a broken window theory. If the broken window is not repaired, it gives an impression that nobody manages the flat, and then the culture will further deteriorate. So hurling a banana would lead the parliamentary culture to further doldrums. So point number three, my point is about the price to pay. There is an impasse in the council leading to an impasse in society. We're backpedaling, and this is not an abstract theory. In fact, we spent a lot of public money in this council, and if we do not have a good set of rules, if we do not have a good sanctioning mechanism, then it will be a problem. According to the Secretariat, we waste $2 million per hour. So filibustering is a real financial issue. Another member mentioned security staff in the council. That is a point raised by Mr. Kwok Wai Kong. He mentioned frequent injuries suffered by security guards. In recent years, members, especially newcomers, failed to consider the personal safety of security guards. Well, they neglected their own personal safety in the first place, but it's really selfish for them not to consider the personal safety of our staff. And indeed, a lot of accidents happened in the past. Comparing to the UK, for members who failed to comply with the president's ruling, we are lagging behind. In the UK, after an order is issued, if a member refuses to leave the chamber on his own, the enforcement officer, such as a sergeant-at-arms or the security guard, would just tap the shoulder of the member, and the member would be barred from participating in parliamentary meetings for the rest of his term. So it's much more stringent. About being rational, once again, at the moment, we do not have a lot of opposing views on restoring parliamentary culture here. It may be a point about our culture. I'm not trying to give a lecture. Indeed, I often compare the council with the court of the law, and we should exercise our wits. We should rely on our eloquence, not physical violence. Like Mr. Wilson Orr often refers to the Kaifengs that he came across. Dr. Priscilla Leung often refers to what she's done over the years. And that's a different style of speech. All in all, it would be beneficial for members as long as we stick to the topic. Mr. Felix Chung's style is really quite succinct. He just makes his points clear without repeating himself. That's also a good thing about debates that help us stick to the bottom of the truth. Only if we have a good parliamentary culture would we be able to achieve that. If we have publicity stunts and grandstanding in the council, definitely you want to gain traction in the media. And on the flip side, the debate will not be efficient. I think this is common knowledge. Another point is about the culture in this council. I understand that the more radical members or opposition members may often cite due process, natural justice, and therefore they need to be combative in this council. It's a matter of making their stance known. I hope that apart from amending the rules of procedure, we can also uphold the good tradition and civility in the council. Of course, the majority rules, but we need to respect the views of the majority. The minority, they should not be left out. I often pay attention to the minority members so that we can have different perspectives on a topic. And after rolling out the initiative of ensuring patriots administer Hong Kong with the NPCSE's amendment to the basic law, we should not stop at these efforts, because if there are grievances in society, it can very much breed conflicts, especially in this council. There should be fewer grievances in society, because we don't want to have confrontations in the council either. Let me clarify that this proposal doesn't entail economic or financial sanction. We deliberated on the proposal, but we decided not to go ahead with it. We have the new withdrawal sanction, but not the financial penalty. It will be left to the next step. Apart from, and also for video conferencing, a motion has been carried to implement this arrangement. As for the analogy put forward by a certain political party, I'd like to clarify about the motion. Now, first, about third reading, there is a saying that members will be deprived of the opportunity to make final remarks after listening to members' views in the debate. Indeed, in the past, members would be given 15 minutes to speak, but very often members would use the time for filibustering instead of making a proper speech, and very often they would not be speaking to the subject. Rule 63 of the existing ROP imposes restrictions on the subject of member speeches, but then we've had bickering on the wording of the article. That is why we propose to restrict the speaking time limit for members from 15 minutes to 3 minutes. In other words, we should not allow members to debate on the merits of the bill during the third reading or engage in another debate. This should be done during the second reading or the resumption of second reading. This is the effect of the proposal. Next, about the adjournment motion debate, Dr. Cheng Chung Tai said that it is a good proposal because every Wednesday we may need to adjourn the council to debate on more urgent and ad hoc issues. We still have the same mechanism, only that the whole debate will be limited to 1.5 hours. So I'd like to clarify with members that in fact we still have the same room for an adjournment motion debate. Finally, I'd like to thank members who have participated in the debate, members of the Committee on Rules of Procedure, and members of the whole Council who have responded very extensively to our consultation exercise. Allow me to say a few more words. And that is my experience in running for election in the past 2 terms as a directly elected member. I've always advocated a healthy democracy. If we do not have a healthy system, healthy culture in a council, we won't be able to contribute to society. In the past, the Committee on Rules of Procedure, on a number of occasions, tried to amend the ROP, but because of the division mechanism, we were not able to do that. Mr. Tommy Zhang used to be quite passive. He said that we should not attempt the impossible, and that's also what he said yesterday. When Mr. Tammy Chong was chair of the CROP, there weren't many amendments. Members ask why we have so many amendments this time. It's a matter of the change in our system. I am delighted to see 2 major amendments to the ROPs within our term. I hope that there will still be room for deliberations. We hope to uphold the good culture of this council so that we have quality debate in this council. Thank you. I now put the question to you, and that is, Mr. Paul Chair's motion be passed. With those in favour, please raise your hands. Mr. Dr. Chan Chong Tai claims the division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
開始表決。
Let's begin to vote. Please verify your votes. If there are no questions, then the result will be displayed for those from the FC. So 23 present, 22 for, 0 against, no abstention. Those from the GC, 17 present, 16 for and 1 against, and no abstention. The motion has been passed by majority of members present. I declare the motion passed. Motion on form, members' motions, non-binding motions. Mr. Kenneth Lau will move a motion.